Good morning, everybody. My name is K. Adam White. You can call me Catum. I am here today to talk about real-world responsive blocks, and I'm really excited to be a part of WordCamp Boston this year in particular with the conference's 10th anniversary. My first conference was on this stage in 2011 at WordCamp Boston 2011, so please a round of applause for this wonderful event. I was a local until last year. I was living in Somerville, and it was the Boston WordPress community that has led me to a career and a community that I deeply, deeply love and appreciate being a part of. That's due to all the people in this room, that's due to all the people who have made the meetup and the WordCamp happen, and I'm very grateful that I have the opportunity to come back and continue sharing things that I find really interesting and that hopefully might benefit you in your work as well. I would definitely encourage anyone in the audience who hasn't spoken but has thought about it, give it a try. Come to a meetup sometime, propose a topic. Everyone in this room knows more about something relevant to what we do than one of the other people here. And so any talk you're going to give on a subject that you care about is going to benefit somebody and is going to help teach someone else in the community, and that's how we all grow together. The thing that I'm here to talk about today, and the topic that I've been really excited about lately, is despite this being a developer track talk, it's more about design. It's specifically about responsive design. We're all likely familiar with responsive design, but it's a pretty interesting topic in the web design industry. I think it's also fun from a Boston perspective, because this kind of became the city of responsive design in a way. We have local residents and agitators and responsive issues instigators like Matt Marquis and Ethan Marcotte here. We have the Boston Globe, which was one of the early, very high-profile responsive sites, being our city newspaper. Responsive design runs deep in Boston. This means that we're all, generally speaking, relatively familiar with the media query, this piece of CSS technology that we can use to adapt our experiences that we give and the designs that we present to the viewport that we're using to view and display the website. We're able to provide the same HTML, the same semantic contents to a cell phone as we do to a desktop, and use CSS to apply the appropriate styling based on the device that we're using. But because this is Boston, we're always slightly dissatisfied as well, and we, over the past couple years, have come to recognize that the media query alone didn't solve everything. This led to a number of other campaigns towards implementing and testing out new technologies such as responsive images and the new image markup that we can take advantage of in WordPress. And it's leading us now towards considering the media query itself and considering how we imagine the scale and the layout of an element on the page to be determined as WordPress steps forward into the block editor phase. And as we start looking at each piece of content as a discrete element, a component, a block, pick your jargon, they're all roughly equivalent. And think about, if we have something like a list of latest posts, how can we make this self-contained? If this is a widescreen, full-width block that I have put onto my page, if I've, on my homepage, set this up so that my latest posts are going to display with nothing else on the side, a media query is a perfect solution. A media query lets me say, if I'm viewing this on a mobile device, I would like these in single column, please. If instead I am viewing it on maybe a flipped widescreen phone or a tablet or a small desktop browser window, maybe two columns would be more appropriate. And then, of course, when you have room, you can break out into three columns or more as a need. And that works great if this block is full width on your screen and if it does span the entire content area. But Gutenberg and the block editor in WordPress ships with some interesting layout tools, one of which is the columns block. If you take that exact same block and you put it into a column, it suddenly has a completely different set of constraints on its size. It has far less than half the available space on the page in order to lay out and in order to be usable. It ends up being very cramped. Those same styles that are applied because we are at a widescreen width don't mean as much when the content itself is squeezed into a sidebar or squeezed into a column, and you start to get interesting line breaks, you start to get text overlap, you can get broken margins. Many people in the room who have built large, complex sites where individual pieces of content get reused in many places, and at many times in places we do not expect, are probably familiar with this problem. We have to divorce our sense of a component from being strictly influenced by that page, and we start having to look at all of the different considerations that might be influenced instead, not by the page, but by the context within the page, the blocks and the nesting of the elements that we're using. Ethan Marcotte has written about this issue and the notion that we might want to start thinking about styling our elements, and we always should have been styling our elements more based on the content and less based on the device. It goes beyond layout. There are typographic considerations. You might want to, if you were seeing the excellent presentation right before this on responsive typography, you may want to actually change the text treatment of a headline if it's occurring in a sidebar or a secondary location on the page versus if it's your masthead. You're going to want to change that visual weight, that content hierarchy, just as much as you're going to want to choose between a single or a double column layout in some cases, as an example. Because WordPress core does ship with known entities like the columns block, we can style around this to some extent. We can say, all right, I know that my recent post block or the custom block that I'm implementing, maybe it's a calendar or a map, I know that this isn't going to look great in a column within a two or three column layout. So I can actually put classes in my styles to say, all right, if I'm on a big enough screen, but I know that I'm within a narrow column, I'm going to unwrap some of those styles that I've added, and I'm going to walk back those media query additions that I put in for the widescreen context and reinstate that mobile first view, because a mobile view and a narrow context view are frequently the same thing. We might have the roughly same considerations for how we display our content, because in both cases it's a narrow amount of screen space. But that's great for something like the WordPress block column, which we know about. Unfortunately, well, fortunately for WordPress, we are seeing every day more plugins get released that are implementing new custom blocks. The support for inner blocks and block nesting is only going to get better and more robust within the WordPress block editor. And so we cannot imagine, none of us could, under any circumstances, ever enumerate every situation in which a block in a plugin that we release on the directory might get used. It's not enough for us to hard code in specific escape hatches for known issues. We need to be able to think of new ways that we could style, not based on the media, not based on the screen that we're using, but based on the element itself. We are finding ourselves part of this very vocal and growing group of web developers who have been wondering about whether we could have element queries. The idea of an element query is very similar to a CSS media query. The notion is that instead of having an app media rule, you can put your media on a specific element. That element will then only accept those styles, it will only process those styles if it is in that, if that media query is fulfilled. So in this case, min width 20m, that would only kick in if my block was actually quite wide and was beyond that 20m width threshold. If we had access to this, we can take that same hypothetical example of handling a narrow column, and we can remove knowledge of the column from the equation. In fact, we can remove knowledge from the screen from the equation. All we have to do is say, the base styles for this are assuming a narrow context, and the layered on styles that we're going to apply as the screen gets bigger will take advantage of whatever space we have available. Sarah Sweden has called element queries and container queries, which are approximately the same thing, the holy grail of responsive web design right now. It's one of the few legendary unattained things that we seek. Chris Coyer has hypothesized that if element queries existed, over 50% of the media queries we write would be element queries. I actually think the real number for that is even higher. I think the vast majority of the styles that I write using media queries, using page size dependence, really should be in relation to a container somewhere farther down on the page. And so, if you're looking at the date on this tweet, this is one of the two kind of obligatory slides you have to have in a talk about container queries and element queries. November 2015, that's quite a while ago now. Why don't we have this? We've been talking about this for a long time. Responsive images took a while to get going, but we were able to build that momentum and get them adopted into browsers so that we could actually move forward and ship features like that in Chrome and Firefox and Edge and eventually WordPress and systems that are built to use those environments. What's going on with element queries? Why don't we have them? Jeremy Keith summed it up really nicely in a post that sort of poked fun at the notion that it's easy to assume a conspiracy theory. It's easy to say, oh, well, browser vendors are always asking us what we want. We're telling them, and they're saying, no, 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 not that, not interested. It's an easy trap to fall into. It's definitely not the truth. The fact of the matter is that browser vendors and web developers are more on the same side on most things than they ever have been. We all want a more accessible, faster web. The issue is that browser vendors have a really strong imperative to maintain that speed. No one has ever said, I'm going to upgrade to a new browser because I've heard it is slower. It's not something that you do. What happens in the computation of the styles on your page is that the browser assembles a complete picture of the HTML, and it assembles a full tree of all of the CSS styles and that cascade, that hierarchy of style rules, and it uses these two things together to generate a layout. The layout is going to answer unresolved questions, for example, how far does content go down if content is wrapping, if text is wrapping within a block, that's going to push that block down. Once that layout recomputation finishes, then the browser can render it on the page. The issue with media queries, element queries, is that it becomes trivial to write a situation that causes an infinite loop. What an element query is doing is causing a feedback loop from the point where you're computing the layout, suddenly that can cause an additional style rule to be added. If that style rule causes another change of the layout, and that triggers another style rule, even assuming that you don't get into an infinite loop situation, that's going to dramatically slow down the browser's ability to efficiently render the page because it's going to be churning and doing all that extra computation. The browser has to know everything about the style tree at layout computation time where it can't render fast. And if you have something like this, which is an element query on an element that says, if I am above 500 pixels, make me less than 500 pixels. Now this is going to just churn forever because there is no way for this to ever be satisfied. It's a paradoxical situation. It's something that we can kind of do already in CSS if you have a hover element that by animating or changing size or position, invalidates or moves itself out from under the mouse, you can get these strange flickers. That's marginally okay if it's a rendered page, but if you're talking about the computation that has to occur before render, this is paralyzing. And so it isn't that browser vendors are against this feature for no good reason. The issue is that browser vendors are challenging us to come up with better solutions. Browser vendors are also experimenting with other options. There is a notion that we could actually mark pieces of our documents as being unrelated to others. I am not really personally one for reading through long technical specs, but I should note that all of the technology that I'm referencing in this is specified out in the open. The CSS Working Group and other organizations are responsible for documenting these things. And if you're interested in it, there is a wealth of material on not only these containment CSS containment properties that Chrome's experimenting with, but the whole reason that container queries have not really hit it off yet is amply documented. I've mentioned Sarah Swinton, I've mentioned Jeremy Keith, I've mentioned Chris Poyer, Brad Frost's articles on A List Apart by Matt Marquis. There's a whole host of excellent, excellent pieces out there that explain the back and forth that we've had within the working groups and between the working groups and the community groups in order to try to get to some sort of consensus about what this is going to look like. But at the end of the day, we're not there yet. And so, a CSS-only solution is out for now, but theoretically I've invited you here this morning to tell you something that is possible rather than to simply build up hope and then dash that hope on a rock. We've, with responsive images, had some success using JavaScript. We've had some success writing code that will implement a new feature before that feature exists in a browser, what we call a polyfill, or a polyfill, or a ponyfill, or a bronyfill, or several other things, as I recall. If we can use JavaScript to implement a solution, maybe we can actually start testing out the syntax options that might work and might resolve some of these hypothetically paradoxical issues that we're seeing. And in fact, there is an excellent CSS extension for element queries. There's in fact several. This is, I think, the most robust and maintained and active. But despite the fact that there's some really excellent work being done here, and the work that is being done in the CSS working group is pushing forward with trying to understand what an element or container query looks like, we are going to largely be ignoring that work. Because I think that our focus on trying to come up with a new CSS syntax to handle this is actually distracting us from solving that original problem that we were trying to figure out how to address, that issue of how, as web developers working today, in July 2019, can we write sites that have components that size themselves based on how big they are on the page rather than the viewport. And it turns out that when we start to divorce our thinking from the syntax a little bit, we remember that there actually are a lot of really existing strong ways to target styles within a container. Chief among them is the class. Putting a class on a container is the absolute easiest way to mark that container as having some sort of self-contained treatment. It's what we use to create blocks, it's what we use to create all sorts of structures in CSS. So could we use containers not just to indicate related function that we can then style as one unit, but could we use class names to indicate how big an element is? We absolutely can, and there have, for a long time, I think, been some experiments that did things like bind to the onResize event in the browser to say, when I resize the page, go through and check these elements, make sure that you know how big they are, and then add a class that's going to indicate whether they're large or small. This is a little slow, and unfortunately, and worse for our context, if you're using the onResize event in the browser, you're actually missing out on any other sort of change, like a panel or sidebar being dragged, accordions opening and closing, menus flying out. There's a lot of things that can alter the positioning and the size of things on a web page beyond that browser window. This gets back to that initial problem where the browser window is actually kind of a false marker for how big things are. So we shouldn't be relying on onResize. The good news is that Chrome, in addition to some of the experiments around CSS containment, for a couple of years now has had an excellent property called ResizeObserver. And ResizeObserver does exactly what it says on the tin. It gives you an object that you can use to listen for size changes on any element in your page. I should preface the rest of this by saying that the talk that really got me inspired about ResizeObserver and about essentially the solution that I'm going to be sharing today as a plugin is based on an excellent presentation by Phil Walton at last year's CSSConf. Phil's an engineer on Google's Chrome and web platform teams and has done a tremendous amount of pioneer work around how we can use ResizeObserver to build responsive components using techniques that are going to work across browsers this morning. I'm sorry, today, not this morning specifically, but metaphorically. And most of what I'm going to be sharing from here on out is derived from some of the excellent blog posts and talks that he's given. So, again, as I mentioned, there's a lot of great articles and a lot of great resources around the element query problem, if you will. There's also some fantastic material about ResizeObserver specifically. So if anything that I'm saying here today is interesting, please feel free to come up and chat with me about it throughout the rest of the weekend, and to go out and to watch some of these other talks to get maybe a little bit more of a full perspective. So the way that ResizeObserver works, and this is where we're going to get into a little bit of JavaScript. At the end, I'm going to try to argue that you don't have to have paid attention, but you may as well. We're going to make sure that ResizeObserver is available first, because it is experimental. And if it is, we're going to create a ResizeObserver and give it a callback function. This entries and the arrow and the equal sign is a way to declare a callback function using new JavaScript syntax, if you're less familiar with that. What we're doing here is we're saying, whenever this ResizeObserver notices a change, run that entry, run that element that has changed through this logic, and that can be anything. We'll come back to that. Once our ResizeObserver has been declared, we can go out and we can look for elements on our page that we want to pay attention to, because it would be extremely inefficient for us to listen for changes on every single element on the page. There's no reason for us to pay attention to the size of a span or an icon tag if the changes to the size of that icon are not going to affect other elements on the page. We want to only put this at that top level where we have containers that we know represent a discrete unit of content that we want to style as a block or as a particular element component. So in this case, we're going to use a data attribute to tag the elements that we want. We're going to, any element that we want to promote to becoming a responsive container, we will give it the data-responsive-container attribute. We'll then use a CSS attribute selector to query for every element on the page where that attribute occurs, and each one of those elements we will pass to our resize observer. We will instruct our observer to listen for resizes on these events. We'll then return to that logic in the callback, the logic that the resize observer is going to actually run when it detects a change. It's going to start and it's going to say, for each entry that's changed, see what its size is. We have this entry.contentRect option. In this callback, it's going to know how big this object has become, and we're going to be able to tag that with various class names. In this case, I'm using container-sn for small, container-md for medium. They're fairly arbitrary, they could be anything, but the notion is, as the element gets bigger, we're going to add additional classes so that we can use the presence of these classes to style the element exactly as if we were using minimum width media queries and that we were treating this as a full width object. We're going to start out by writing our narrow context first styles, what we would normally have done as mobile first. And as the element gets bigger, as we have more room available, we can start to layer in additional styling and additional layout. This means that we can really achieve that idea of writing styles that are going to be container size specific without using either the original CSS media queries or any new CSS element query syntax. All we need to do is our classes. If we have a container that we know is going to be receiving these, we can use the presence or absence of these different container classes to write styles that are going to apply to particular types of elements on the page in particular contexts. And again, we can get this once we set that JavaScript up once. We can get this on any element in our page with nothing more than dropping a data attribute onto it. However, as I'm sure most of you have amply experienced in your careers, no website is, or no tool is one size fits all to all the websites we build. Each website has its own style guide, its own layout rules, its own different column widths, and having some sort of arbitrary set of default classes gets you part of the way there, but it doesn't really help you if you want to customize the sizing of the elements on your page. The good news is that attributes can actually take values, and in this case, we're going to assign each one of these attributes a JSON string, a stringified JavaScript object, of the names of the classes and the sizes at which to apply them for a particular element. Now we'll have the default handling for all of the general classes where it'll get the small, medium, or large containers if we do nothing more than this. But if instead we know that when we're at 400 pixels, we're going to want to have a one column layout, and once it's above 800, we can jump to a two column, we could actually use those more meaningful class names. We could use BIM styling. We could say, you know, dash dash modifier to the class and use whatever format and whatever structure we want to leverage in our project and on our plugins. If we do this, and I'm going to pull up an animation of the calendar example from Phil Walton's responsive components demo site, then we can write something that we write as a single unit as if it was full page width, and we're using these classes to intelligently switch between layouts when we have the right amount of room to make them work. This is actually a really great demo site. There's a number of different demos out here, all of which demonstrate the different examples that were put together for some of the talks that I referenced earlier. But that's great in the abstract. How do we bring this back to WordPress? How do we make this something where we can take advantage of it in any theme or plugin without having to do all that extra legwork? And it's for this purpose that over the past couple of months I've been trying to work with some of my colleagues and some other people I know in the community to come up with a good baseline of functionality that we could provide as a plugin. And this past week, through the good grace of the plugins team, I was able to get a plugin released that provides a toolkit for implementing this. I've been using WordPress for 12 years, and I've been working with it in a major way for much of that time. I've written dozens of plugins for clients. This is actually my first released plugin on the plugin directory. So if you're using it and it's not working right, please let me know. Work with you to address it. But this will do, out of the box, nothing. It's not quite true. If you install my plugin, it will load a JavaScript snippet onto your page that writes out the code that I was showing you, or code very much like it, that will say, if I see an element with a data responsive container attribute, opt that element in to resizes. Then in your PHP code, if you start using that attribute, if you start including data responsive container in either your markup that you're rendering out from PHP, or if you're writing HTML from a block, you could theoretically write this to the markup that you save into the post in JSX or in React. Then this plugin will automatically detect that and start tagging those elements with these additional class names in a way that you can start to leverage in your theming and your styling to write styles based on how big that element is going to appear. The plugin also supports that JSON encoded syntax that I mentioned, where we can say, I want these particular class names at these widths for this element. If you're writing out the attribute, you can assign a value to it, which in PHP would be escaping a JSON string, or in JavaScript, React does some of the escaping for you, so I believe you can simply pass the object through JSON stringify, and you can say, for example, fancy block 2 column should kick in after 600 pixels, and fancy block 3 column above 900. We do tend in the design community these days, as I understand it, to prefer not using pixel dimensions in all cases. It is what we are limited to here because those are the values that we're receiving from that resize observer. So if you are building your site predominantly in ims or predominantly in some other unit of width, you might need to do a little bit of conversion to figure out the right points at which to kick these in. So I'm going to pull up a demo site so that we can see how that looks when we start to load this plugin and we start to try to use this code to fix one of these layout issues. And I don't, yeah, cool, that does work. I will use this microphone. So here we have our initial grid of images. Shout out to the turkeys out front today. And here we have our two-column version that we were struggling to style in a way that we found useful. So, if we're looking at this, it's the same six posts, three-column layout that we saw earlier in the presentation. That's a little cramped. We're going to take our latest post block, and we're actually going to filter the output of that using the render block function, filter. As long as we're processing the latest post block, we're going to actually inject, using a regular expression word or just string replacement, we're going to inject the data responsive container attribute into our component so that any latest post block will now be found and tagged by the plugin and created as a resize observer target. I'm then going to write, in this case, actually some extremely janky CSS to fix the layout. Normally you would be writing much better CSS to progressively build the layout up as the element gets bigger. In this case, we're just trying to undo the work that WordPress does for us out of the box in the least amount of time possible. So, this plugin that I was viewing here is an active plugin. It hasn't yet kicked in, but I do have responsive containers active, and so if I apply the plugin that we have in the background here that adds that data attribute, and we inject that CSS into the document, now when I pop back over here and reload, it's going to get the proper layout that I would want. And the markup for this, because they're using the same block with the same options, is identical. But on this one, we now have different categories and different classes that our plugin has added in order for us to be able to target it in this way. So, I think this is pretty exciting. I think this is how I'm certainly going to be building blocks for projects that we build at my company in the future. But if I were you in the audience, would have a couple of questions. The first of them would be around browser support. And the future looks extremely good on this front. Partly through the mixed blessing of Edge migrating to WebKit, we're going to be getting the Resize Observer in one of the next couple versions of every major desktop browser. They should eventually follow on mobile browsers, but mobile browsers are usually designed for that narrow context, so the problem that this solution is designed to solve is at least somewhat less prevalent on mobile, so the lack of them there is a little bit less of an impact. And because these are all future browsers, in the plugin we do ship a polyfill for Resize Observer. There's code that implements what Resize Observer does, even in browsers like IE11 and Edge that do not currently support it. This means that if we're willing to incur a few additional kilobytes of JavaScript and some microseconds of latency, we can start using this everywhere on the web today. The other good news is that the performance is pretty good. It's extremely good when Resize Observer is supported natively, and it's pretty great even when the polyfill is involved, because you're not trying to do too much. It's not listening for every document resize event or every layout. It's only reacting to very specific changes on the page. And the fallback, if you've written a block using this structure, the fallback would be that that block ends up with your mobile styling. So this is a tab with JavaScript disabled. And so none of the styling for this responsive containers demo site has kicked in. And what we see is that all of these elements get their mobile treatment. It's certainly not ideal for a desktop context, these sort of line-by-line calendar views, but it's a lot better than having nothing there or having it not work at all. So this is something that should work whether JavaScript is enabled or disabled. It's a progressive enhancement in the truest sense of the word. As I mentioned, this plugin came out very recently, and I'm excited about the release. I'm certainly hoping that both at this event and through collaborating with some other people online and in our community across the web, we can continue making this a better tool for us to be using in your projects and using in our different themes and plugins. So there's a lot we could do. We could provide a React component that implements some of this behavior for you. We could provide better helper methods to make it easier to mark individual blocks or containers as being a responsive container. What's going to drive that, I think, is up to a discussion between all of us and between the WordPress community and the broader CSS and web communities about what sorts of hooks and features and filters we want to see in order to take advantage of the possibilities of browsers that we have today for building styles that are truly independent of the context of the page and really react more to what layout you're using, whether they're in a column, whether they're in a sidebar, whether they're a widget within a widget within a widget. These are the interesting layout challenges. We should be thinking about layout and design in general from content first. We should be thinking about what's appropriate for our content, our blocks, at whatever size they may occur, and we should be able to expect our community and our browsers to provide tools to help us get there. I'm hoping that what I've shared today might inspire you and might at least encourage you to read up on the topic and adopt some of the techniques that I'm proposing in your projects, even if you don't end up using this plugin at all, or even if you don't think that a plugin's the right way to make this a reusable, distributable technology. I certainly hope that will continue the conversation, and I really look forward to talking to you all about it throughout the rest of the weekend. Thank you. That's a great question. The question, if you didn't catch it, was why ResizeObserver is the correct tool versus some of these other options we have for detecting changes on a page, like listening to an on-resize event, or I suppose by queuing or including one of those other more nascent element query polyfills. Is that accurate? The answer is largely performance. If you're using ResizeObserver, particularly in a browser where it is natively supported, it's going to be running fewer times, it's going to be running on more specific triggers. So you're going to be able to expect your page to react faster, and you're not going to have to worry about pulling the document or ending up with unrelated JavaScript running when you're trying to have a button highlight or some animation run or something else where running arbitrary code might interrupt or delay that. So it's predominantly performance. The reason that you would want to use what I'm proposing instead of some of the polyfills that we have around the proposed element query syntax would instead be that syntax is much more likely to change. And if I have to pick between a tool that is largely adequate to the job and I know will work the same way in a week, and a tool that is perfect for the job but might cause me to have to redo my work in a week, I'm going to pick the more reliable tool. So those are the two major arguments I've heard against that. I have existing tools, or I want to use these newer, more experimental tools. And my argument to that would, again, to reiterate, be that I like to preference the one that's going to be the fastest and the one that's going to be the stablest. At the moment, I believe that to be ResizeObserver. Gentlemen in the yellow.
On your chart, you mentioned that it
thinks
that iOS Safari was not supported this.
The question was about the fact that Android and iOS do not currently support ResizeObserver, and yes, in that case, because it is unsupported, we would load the polyfill and it would run, so we would have the ability to take advantage of that. But the flip side of that is that there's actually fewer, I mean, certainly if you have an iPad Pro, this is not the case at all, and you would absolutely need this. But across the landscape of devices running those operating systems in general, the majority are going to be smaller screen devices where you're not going to end up hitting those wider breakpoints that would be used to progressively layer on that additional styling. Now, if you're on an iPad, if you're on a big screen or you're plugged into something, then absolutely the polyfill will kick in and it should work as normal in that context.
Last one?
Yeah. Okay. Here in the front.
Do you think this is something that Gutenberg core block should and could support natively?
Well, the question is, do you think this is something that Gutenberg core blocks could or should support natively? And I think it absolutely is something that they could support natively. I think should is a discussion that I would love for this project to kick off. I think that it would be really interesting to talk with the folks that are working on this from the browser perspective and from the CSS community perspective to understand whether we think this is a good solution for us to adopt in core long term. Sure. The question there was, do you want to make an issue? I think that's time, so thank you all again for coming, thank you for the great questions, and have an excellent, excellent working.